second in the Western Division. Adam Amin, Mac Brown, Don Davenport, and you're looking at Frank Wilson, the first-year head coach of UTSA, taking this team to its first-ever bowl game. Bob Davey is the head man for the New Mexico Lobos in their second consecutive bowl game and 13th all-time. It is Jalen Rhodes getting the carry on second down and four, running into Cody Baker. And it'll bring up third down, opening drive of the game, opening 2 minutes. And UTSA, with a 38-yard run from Jarvion Williams, got deep into New Mexico territory.
Frank Selfo, the offensive coordinator that came in from the Jacksonville Jaguars to UTSA. He's really, really good on third and short. And they know they've got to make these type situations to stay on the field and keep that option attack of New Mexico off the field.
Fifth play of the drive, and it is the fifth run. It is Jalen Rhodes trying to move the chains, and he's got it to the 25-yard line. Starting up Capital One Bowl Mania, it's the first of 38 FBS bowls. It's one of the best times of year. Mac, why do coaches like bowl season so much?
Adam, coaches like it because they get 13-plus practices. They've got total focus of their players. There's no school, unlike spring practice. So these guys have an extra spring practice, and you can hit the entire time and be better prepared when you start in the spring.
You see the gusting winds. They've been gusting up to 40 miles an hour, so expect the running game to be a factor today. This is the first pass of the day, and it's off the fingertips of Shaq Williams. The tight end, who's had a couple of touchdowns this year, could not snare it on that Sturm delivery.
This is a good job faking the run. They haven't thrown a pass yet in this game until now. They get the receiver slipping down inside. The tight end, Shaq Williams, had him wide open, throwing into the wind. The ball is going to flutter. It may take a different path going to the receiver. So could be hard to catch a ball today. That's really not on the quarterback or receiver. I'd give that one to the wind.
They're going into that gusting wind, as Mac mentioned. So they'll go back to the ground in a burst for Rhodes, and he dives down to the 20-yard line on a 5-yard run to set up third down and five. 11th Gildan New Mexico Bowl. New Mexico out of the Mountain West Conference, and UTSA out of Conference USA. New Mexico trying to get its first bowl win in 9 years and just its second in the last 54, while UTSA, as we mentioned, first ever bowl appearance. They went 5 years with Larry Coker, the former national championship winning head coach. They won 7 games, they won 8 games, but they weren't bowl eligible until 2014. This is their first bowl game. Trying to get the offense set up and an empty set for Sturm on third and five. And Sturm, a very good athlete, will get shut down by Kimmy Carson at the 20-yard line. That'll bring up fourth down.
Kevin Cosgrove, the defensive coordinator for New Mexico. He was at Nebraska. He was at Wisconsin. He knows how to dial them up front. And he brought the extra linebacker there, Kimmy Carson, for the sack against the no-back formation with UTSA.
Now, Mac, from here, it'd be about a 37-yard field goal, which is within Victor Falcone's range. Not today.
Not today.
Wind.
May blow back behind you. That wind is blowing, and that's why you can see UTSA running the ball so much early. All of them on the line of scrimmage. Looks like Cosgrove may be bringing six. Now they back out. Probably going to play coverage.
And a whistle before the snap, and there may be a timeout here.
UTSA, that's their first time out of the half.
So UTSA will indeed think about it on fourth
down.
This
will be a 30-second timeout.
Now, we talked about the wind already, and we don't always get a chance to show you the great job by our production crew to tell you what happened before the game, but the wind has been a major factor. We've got good special teams units for these teams, but look at the field goal movement. And these are from 35 yards out, so about this distance. I want you to look at this third one. Watch the movement of this ball from a good kicker in Jason Sanders. It blows your mind, the hooking and drawing that you see. I mean, it's going one way and the other.
Now, wind is the biggest factor in a football game, much more than rain, because the wind does it really changes the trajectory of the ball. Usually, your rule of thumb is your offensive game plan is that you're going to line up and run the football into the wind, and you can throw with it, but you're going to run basically into it Now they're in a long yardage situation here at fourth and five, which for fourth downs long, I think you'll see a bunch and a pick route probably to the top.
They'll work out of the gun with Williams next to Stern. They'll fire to the flat. It is caught for the first down by Williams. Chased down by an excellent tackler in Dakota Cox, but we have our first fourth down conversion of the day. We might see a lot of them today.
Yes, if you're an offensive coach, you call this a rub route, where the receiver comes inside and he makes Cox run around him, and he gets your receiver free in the flat. If you're on defense, you call it a pick route. And Coach Cosgrove told us yesterday, they're going to pick us all day. And I said, well, they'll call it a rub, Coach.
Of course, from an offensive mind like Matt Brown's, why wouldn't you call it that? Here is Williams on the edge. Not much room there, and he ends up losing a couple of yards, chased out by Maurice Daniels. You can hear the wind in our mics on the field, how hard these gusts are coming in. And I know, you know, it is New Mexico. You get weather like this in Albuquerque at this time of year, but both teams worked with a lot of conditional stuff over the course of the week, trying to do whatever they possibly could in the cold and in the wind during practices leading up to this bowl game to prepare.
And it's in the 40s, and the wind is making it feel much colder than that with wind chill.
A long UTSA drive to start the day. 11th play, a bad snap handled by Sturm, and he will take off. And he'll slip out of bounds. It'll be third down, and we'll line him up at the 10-yard line. Third and nine coming up here. They can get a first down without scoring.
Yeah, two really good plays by number 58, Maurice Daniels, the defensive end. He's their best pass rusher, but he pushed the sweep toward the boundary on the last play and did a great job tackling Strum on the scramble on that play.
New Mexico has a veteran defensive group in a 4-2-5 defense. Four wide receiver look, three by one here.
I think again we see fade to the field.
And it is to Josh Stewart, their leading receiver, and it's knocked away by I.B. Brown, the senior from San Antonio, playing for New Mexico. Great coverage against the leading receiver of UTSA.
Well, and we saw Josh Stewart make one of the better plays that I've ever seen a receiver make over at Texas A&M in the corner. He's their tall guy. He's their go-to guy. Anytime they can get single coverage with him, they're going to throw it up. Really good play by Brown.
So here on fourth down, they will try from 27 yards. Falcone will have to bust one, and a lot of heat on that one. You have to power it through the wind. And Victor Falcone, the sophomore out of Comfort, Texas, puts UTSA on the board with its first ever bowl points. For those of you on ESPN News, slide over to ESPN. We'll continue over there. Good running backs towards the top of the charts at those respective schools. Pretty good running backs coach in Frank Wilson did a great job at LSU. And now the first-year head coach at UTSA, and his team has a lead in a bowl.
And Adam, a couple of things. When they've scored first six times this year, they've won five of the ball games. So scoring first is very important. Also, control the clock for 6 minutes and 19 seconds.
Well, the wind plays havoc with that kickoff from Daniel Portillo, and out of bounds on a procedure penalty. So decent field position for New Mexico to start their first drive.
And if you're Bob Davey, you want to take the wind in the first quarter because you want to get adjusted to the wind, but also it gives you a chance to get ahead of the ball.
Out of bounds on the kicking team. The receivers elect to take the ball at the 35-yard line. First down.
Sunbelt officiating crew led by Jason MacArthur today. And New Mexico will start at the 35-yard line, the nation's number one rushing offense. Bob Davey always wanted to run the triple option, but didn't feel like he could do it at Notre Dame. He's done it here at New Mexico, and Lamar Jordan, one of two quarterbacks that New Mexico has used all season long, he's the more true triple option style QB. He's coming off a career-high 176 rushing yards against Wyoming in a blowout win. Redshirt junior out of Frisco, Texas. And on first down, Terrion Gibson staying on his feet. And Terrion Gibson, who leads the country in yards per carry, turns nothing into a lot to the 39-yard line of UTSA, 27 yards.
Terrion's averaging 9.23 yards per carry, and he just made it bigger, Adam, with that play. They start out with an isolation play to the left. He's starts to bounce outside to the left, turns, comes all the way back around to the right, makes the huge gain. That's the kind of explosive plays that UT San Antonio cannot continue to give up today.
It is a true triple option offense, although you can really call it a bit of a wishbone style offense because they can run out of the gun or the pistol. But it's three options almost every play, and Richard McCorley, one of several running backs that New Mexico will use, gets stacked up after a gain of two.
It's a triple option like the wishbone out of the shotgun because it gives you a better opportunity to throw. Now, Coach Davey told us they want to throw about eight times per game. So if they're throwing more than that, they're in trouble, and they have to hit some one-on-ones today. Terrion Gibson, we've already seen, impact player, leads the country in rushing. And you start looking at linebacker Josiah Teaupa. He is a downhill player. He's tough, and he's going to have to play that option inside out all day to try to slow down the triple option of the Lobos.
Now sliding to the left is McCorley, trying to find space, and he'll bang his way down to the 33 into Laquelle Bass. Third down coming up.
And they call McCorley the Rock. He's a big guy. He's 220. He's their short yardage and goal line guy. But they want to stay in third and short because they've been really, really good on third down the last six games of the season as well.
McCorley, for Bob Davey this year, has put in 16 touchdowns. He has 23 on 181 carries, about one touchdown every eight carries for his career.
Got third down here. I think you still see him stay with the option.
McCorley, one of the backs out there. It is a late pitch from Jordan, and nothing there. Sniffed out by UTSA's defense. Gibson forced out of bounds by an excellent safety we'll talk about today, Michael Iguagu, Conference USA second teamer.
The coaches told us yesterday the safeties like Iguagu have got to come up and make plays on the option, be downhill. He played leverage with his outside arm. He turns it up inside. What a great stop.
So Corey Bohorquez, junior out of California, will punt away. Now they're going with the wind, but it is a swirling wind.
And it's important they stop this inside the 10 and really back UTSA up.
And again, the wind's just going to carry it into the end zone. So it ends up being a net punt of just 16 yards there for New Mexico. Six to play, first quarter, UTSA 2016. Took over for Larry Coker, his first head coaching job after 6 years as the running back coach and recruiting coordinator for Les Miles at LSU. And as Mac mentioned, they've won five of the six games this year in which they've scored first. Dalton Sturm, under pressure from Donnie White, flings it away. Was he out of the pocket, and did the ball get past the line of scrimmage? Otherwise, it's intentional grounding. UTSA has had issues the last couple of years, especially in protecting their quarterback.
Yeah, Maurice Daniels, 58, and Donnie White, number 54, defensive ends for the Lobos are really, really quick. They're good pass rushers. They've got length with long arms, and they'll play the option well, but they're going to play power and get pressure on Strum throughout the day.
So officials felt that it was past the line of scrimmage and outside the pocket when Sturm released it, so no intentional grounding. And Sturm, an athletic quarterback, will run it to the 26, brought down by Jacob Gergel on a run of 6 yards.
Dalton Sturm, such a fun story. Walk on, he was a waiter and trying to make enough money to go to school. We saw his mom and friend earlier out there, but this guy can do a 360 dunk. He's a really good athlete. He's an adequate runner like we saw there, but a very good passer.
You said it. He was a walk-on who was working at Chewy's Tex-Mex restaurant in San Antonio, waiting tables to pay for his books and tuition. And when he finally got the starting job last year is when he quit his job at Chewy's. The rush against Sturm forces him to his left and incomplete. Trying to find Jabryce Taylor. And he'll bring up third down.
Really good contain. Yes, really good contain by Dick DeVanzio. The guy's an all-out player, plays hard all the time. He stopped Strum from sprinting to the outside, made him throw a little bit premature. That's a really good stop. So now we should have a short punt into the wind, and New Mexico should have really good field position. So, and Adam, you're running out of time in this first quarter, so you need points with the wind. That is key for New Mexico on this drive.
So Yanni Rutsis will punt away, and he gets a pretty good punt off into that win. Chris Davis Jr. will get chopped down after a very short return.
Another thing about even punting, if you're...
.com, Bob Davies said he always wanted to run the triple option at Notre Dame because they played the service academies every year. Didn't feel like it would translate to the type of kid you get at Notre Dame, but at New Mexico, he has turned it into the great equalizer. The top rushing offense in the country with explosiveness. 11 touchdowns on the ground of 50 or more yards. That's the most since the Colin Kaepernick-led Nevada Wolfpack in 2009. And here is Jordan, and there goes Lamar Jordan, and had it not been for a ankle tackle saving a long run by Iguagu, he would have been gone.
And Lamar Jordan's a dynamic runner. Bob DeBoise, the offensive coordinator for the Lobos, wanted him to go north and south. You see him plant his foot to the outside, and he's darting up the field. He's got great speed. So they need to get points on the board because we're running out of time here in the first quarter, and they're going to lose the win.
Lamar Jordan out of Frisco, Texas. He's got the distinct triple option style and giving it to Owens. He works into UTSA territory. Talk to me about win. When you're a coach, you're an offensive guy, Mac. When you're calling plays, why did you want the win? Why did you want to go with the win?
Well, we were at Iowa State one year, and Tom Osborne was at Nebraska. He took the win, gave us the ball, and I said, well, that's stupid. What's this guy doing? They were up 17 to nothing. They had us on a three and out. We punt short into the wind. They score. Punt short into the wind, they score. Point short, I said, that guy probably knows what he's doing. He's been around a long time. So the wind is the biggest factor of this game today.
I'm gonna see Bill Belichick and the Patriots tomorrow. He often goes with the wind because he wants to run the football well.
Absolutely.
Busting through is Tyrone Owens. Speaking of running the football well, New Mexico does it as well as anybody in the country. And he's out to the 38-yard line, a first down for Tyrone Owens, who did not play in their game against Wyoming due to a foot injury against Colorado State. He's back in the mix for a good running offense. They'll only throw the ball maybe 7-8 times a game. They threw the ball 5 times against Wyoming and completed 4 for 122 yards and a touchdown.
Yes, we threw it about 8 times against A&M once and completed 7. I was mad. We shouldn't have thrown it any. Cedric Benson just ran up and down the field.
They load up the backfield again. Jordan stretching it, will keep it and get a good gain close to the sticks. Down to the 29-yard line with Nate Gaines, the safety, making the stop.
Lamar Jordan did an excellent job on this option because he stretches it to the field and you're trying to find the defender downfield to push it off of. So they've got a load blocker inside. Lamar Jordan, come all the way out. You either pitch off that outside defender or turn it up. And when he knows he can make more than 4 yards, like he did there, he's going to take the yards, plant the foot, and go north and south like Coach DeBess wanted him to do when we were talking to him last night.
On second and short, and a good cut by Gibson. He's got the first down, down to the 23-yard line. Mikel Bass was there for the stop after a 6-yard run. UTSA's defensive coordinator is in his first year, like everybody else in the staff. Pete Golding, who spent the last couple of years at Southern Miss, and we asked him, hey, what worries you about playing the triple option? He just kind of sarcastically laughed and said, where do I start, essentially? There is difficulty in guarding a triple option offense.
Yes, they make you be disciplined. They're going to make you defend all 11 from defense because one guy messes up and you can give up the score.
Stretch to the near side again. It's McCorley inside the 10, first down and goal. Devron Davis finally chased him out. 17 yards for Richard McCorley coming off a 3-touchdown game against Wyoming.
Well, what we're seeing is these running backs that we've heard about and watched on video are for real. This guy's 220 pounds, McCorley, the rock. He gets it up inside and then he even bounces outside. So we're seeing Gibson, Owens, McCorley, and Lamar Jordan take the ball and get explosive plays early in the game, which does not bode well for the Roadrunners.
There is the first-year coordinator, Pete Golding. Nightmare is about the triple option. Punching it through is McCorley, and did he get in? He is marked just shy, and not by much. It'll set up second down and goal from the shadow of the goal line.
Well, and when your name's Rock, you're probably going to get it again.
Yeah.
And you've got 16 touchdowns. This is just a power play. Up inside, they've got an H-back or running back that they have in the backfield lead, and he just goes north and south. And got you. Number 8, the tight end H-back, was the lead blocker on that play. I think we see something similar to McCorley up inside.
23 touchdowns in his career. And drilled by who you talked about, Mac, as an impact guy, the redshirt freshman linebacker, Josiah Talaefa out of Corinth, Texas.
Talaefa is the guy that they all love. They follow this guy.
That's their first time out of the
half. He's a downhill player.
This will be a 30-second timeout.
He's tough, he's smart, and he takes that 220 pounds with McBorley and puts him on his back.
You don't often see a timeout called at the end of the first quarter with 2 seconds to go. If you didn't understand why we were harping on going with the win so much, this is how much it means to Bob Davey right now. But Talaefa, a single season school record, 104 tackles. Dawn, this guy is special. The UTSA staff raved about Talaefa yesterday.
Yeah, they really did, and I've been watching him on the sideline. He is such a leader, and you got to remember, this guy's a redshirt freshman, so coming in, he had done nothing on the field before. One of his teammates told me that during conditioning this past summer, he stood up. They had wrapped up their session. He stood up and said, oh, no, we're not done yet. We have one more sprint to do because we are a team that does above and beyond what we need to do, and he said he just really gained the respect of his teammates at that point, and he's kept it all season long.
We'll see if his defense can make the stop. Again, if New Mexico scores here, they'll have an easier go at it for the extra point as well at the end of the first quarter with 2 seconds to play.
And the kickoff.
And the kickoff as well.
Which is huge for you start talking about field position. I think they go with McWorley up inside again.
Now at the end of the quarter, they'd have to switch sides.
Well, they would switch.
So they'd have to kick into the wind no matter what. But the extra point would still be kicked to these goalposts if they can score at the end of this first quarter.
And I can tell you, that's why Bob has been worried about
game
no
clock
points.
Operator, please reset the game clock to 8 seconds.
Now
eight
they're
seconds,
hoping.
Please.
That's what I was talking about.
Yep, there you go. So now if you score
it's
right here.
Bob. Hey, look, buddy.
Yeah, baby.
I don't want to kick into the wind. That's why I call a timeout.
If you score here and you get the extra point, and you get to kick off in this direction on the other side, it's huge.
Changes field position completely.
On the ground, it is The Rock. McCorley busting past the plane, and he's got the touchdown for the 24th time in his New Mexico career.
These guys have an amazing combination of just power football. This was just a dive play up inside off of the option, and The Rock, McCorley, scores his 17th touchdown going north and south.
And as I mentioned, he's got 24 on about 185 carries in his career. So the extra point for Jason Sanders extends his school record to 82 straight. It's 7-3 New Mexico as we check in with Chris Cotter in the studio. Welcome to bowl season, pal. Thanks very much, Chris. 7-3, New Mexico on top. Final seconds of this first quarter. And celebrating its 12th year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets. Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. To date, Allstate has contributed millions in scholarship funds.
We're so lucky to have all the sponsors that we have, Adam, for bowl games. Bowl games are so important to the coaches. They're important to fans, their reward, but they're most important to the student athlete. And we don't do enough for student athletes. This gives these guys a chance to get some gifts, to have a fun Christmas or holiday away from home, and get a little money to travel and see places they haven't seen. So thank you to Gildan today and the sponsors throughout all the bowls. Thank you for ESPN for letting us see all these. It's a real fun month.
It really is one of the best times of year in sports. So because Bob Davey took that timeout and they scored at the end of the first quarter, they get to kick with the wind. They don't have to kick into it. And on a touchback, UTSA will have it at the 25-yard line.
The biggest strategies today will come because of the wind.
Yep.
And that'll be the head coach's decision on both sides.
Makes offense a little easier. You're not going to pass as much. New Mexico doesn't pass that much anyway. And you're going to try to bang it on the ground and try to get your work done there.
Now, it may not make offense easier. It makes it simpler.
Simpler. I say yes. That's a good way. That's yes. A great way to say it, my friend.
If they stop the run and you're trying to throw into that 40-mile-an-hour wind. We actually played a game at Iowa State, and I saw a quick out, and the ball was blown back behind the quarterback. We had to try to figure out whether it was a fumble or not.
10 rushes, 5 passes so far, and the rushes have been much more lucrative for UTSA to start their day. So the final play of the first quarter will be a Sturm pass. And he's going to take a shot. It's a wobbler down the middle. And good pressure coming in by Taylor Timmons. They're looking downfield for Josh Stewart. First 5-yard line on second down.
In bowl practice, you've got about a month to change things, so guys should have a better feel in the second quarter of how they're going to play them.
It is a draw play for Jarvion Williams. And Jarvion, near midfield, finally forced out by Daniel Henry to the 48-yard line. It's 23, and beg your pardon, it was Jalen Rhodes on the run.
And this is just your drop back pass draw play. You get all the rushers to go upfield because you threw it on first down. You hand it up underneath, the guys run out, all the linemen are pass protecting. Really good check by Dalton Sturm at the line of scrimmage.
Rhodes has 9 touchdowns this year. That's a UTSA record, and Jarvion Williams is the all-time leading rusher, over 2,200 yards in his career. A very good tandem for the Roadrunners. Here is Rhodes angling right and is able to slip past 2 tackles and power for a first down. Into Maurice Daniels. Out of bounds at the 35-yard line.
We're seeing a lot of good backs in this ball game.
Yeah.
We can see here that Kevin Cosgrove blitzed up inside. And then the running back had some patience. It's a stretch play, and he outruns people to the corner. Dakota Cox is a really good player up inside. Sometimes he has a deficiency of getting the speed to the outside against a fastback.
They'll swing it out to Kerry Thomas Jr. and the second leading receiver for this team. The junior out of College Station, Texas, takes it to the 29-yard line, 5 yards on the play. You talked about Dalton Sturm, Goliad, Texas native, a town that has significant and great history, but a population of less than 2,000. His high school class had 92 kids in it. He was a hurdler, a very flashy point guard, and a very athletic football player, even though he was a very slim player. He was a slim QB at 165 pounds in high school. Jarvion Williams gets stuffed by Dakota Cox. That'll bring up 3rd down and 7 on a loss of 2.
And this is exactly what they expect Dakota Cox to do. He's a tough guy. He's got good instincts. He's only 7 tackles away from 400 tackles. So you're watching 49 come inside out, and that's what he's got to do to stop these good backs the rest of the day.
He's on pace to become the first Lobo to lead his team in tackles in 4 consecutive years. Even Brian Urlacher didn't do that. Brian Urlacher is in town today.
Yeah, he was up here earlier. He's really big. We don't want to tell him.
He didn't hear that.
No. No, you're good, Brian.
He's standing about 5 feet away. Sturm down the middle, and it was nearly hauled in by Josh Stewart. Mac, you mentioned it. He made a ridiculous one-handed catch against Texas A&M today. He's got big, strong hands. Just couldn't corral it there. And decision time on 4th down and 7.
Well, and we're seeing now that Frank Selfo has opened up the playbook with the wind. We talked about that. He threw it a couple of times into the wind. He's thrown it now half the time coming back. Sturm cannot miss that pass. He has to put that one on him. He's a good player. But if you get it anywhere near Stewart, he's going to catch it.
New Mexico just got its 12th man off the field. And Sturm in the empty set on 4th down. Throws to the sticks, and it's incomplete. Marquez McNair, the nephew of Steve McNair, could not corral it. And a couple of tight passes go for incompletions on 3rd and 4th down.
And we were bragging on Dalton Sturm. That was a perfect throw. And they got the distance they needed. The Marquez McNair has to catch the ball. You've got to get past the chains. It's a good protection, good drop back, good throw. Hits him on the numbers to the outside. You got to catch the ball, Marquez. That's a huge play because you've got the wind, and you need to be scoring touchdowns when you have the wind.
So now expect, as per usual, a heavy dose of run from New Mexico going into the wind here. New Mexico on top 7-3, and it's Gibson running right. Not a whole lot there, but he'll push for 2 or 3 yards. Last drive for New Mexico was lucrative. We take a look back with our Gildan drive recap, and as per usual, getting it done with multiple weapons on the ground was New Mexico.
Yeah, you started with a quarterback, Lamar Jordan can run, but he's got three backs, not two. Just two are over 1,000 yards, but Big McCorley took over that time and took him down for his 17th touchdown. But when you've got a guy like Lamar Jordan, he's so dynamic, he can score on any play.
Four different rushers in this game have a double-digit yard run already, including Terrion Gibson, who gets swung down at the 35-yard line. Jordan Moore, the former LSU Tiger and TCU Horn Frog, was there to make the stop. He did not play football at LSU. He did at TCU.
Well, and the Roadrunners are doing a good job against the option. You got to make him pitch it as early as he can, and then you have to run it down from inside out. And that was a good tackle. Looked like it might should have been a face mask or even grabbing from behind and pulling him down. But it was a good tackle by Moore in space, and that's tough to do when you're trying to tackle Gibson.
Yeah, in real time, I thought there may have been a flag thrown when we got a better look at it. Clearly, it was a clean play. Jordan rolling right, trying to beat a defender to the edge in Ben Cain, and he does. It was Cain trying to cut off the angle, but it was the speed of Lamar Jordan that got him 16 yards and a first down to move the chains.
Just unfair when you're one-on-one and you're a defensive lineman in space with Lamar Jordan. This guy can fly. He's not very big. He's listed at 5'10", 178. I'm not sure he's that big, but man, can he run. Smart play. They lost contain. He knew where the down and distance was and got the first down.
Looks like another Lamar that a lot of people have gotten used to over the course of this season with his athletic ability. A lot of the comparisons, just because of the name certainly being Lamar, to Lamar Jackson, the Heisman winner, but there is significant talent in this offense that fits Lamar Jordan very well as McCorley takes it on first down to the 46-yard line.
And Bob DeBess, offensive coordinator, came here with Bob Davey from Sam Houston State when they were going to the playoffs. Just about every year.
Yep.
He's done an amazing job of combining an I-formation power game with a triple option game and some passes out of the shotgun. They're really, really good at what they do. They're confident. They know what they're doing. They can run it in so many different ways. And he said the receivers are really good.
They've run the ball 17 times on 17 plays. And then around this area of the field, you got to watch out for the play over the top. Now, granted, they're still going into the wind. Keep it on the ground with Jordan. Really good job by UTSA to force that to the sideline. You want to make a tough decision, even tougher for a quarterback as you stretch him out to the edge.
Yes, you've got to slow play him and not let him turn up. And Iguagu that time played it perfectly. He shuffled, he waited, he kept Lamar from turning up, he made him pitch it, and he had the boundary as his friend, and then he ran it down inside out to the boundary. Perfect play by Iguagu.
Iguagu playing in his 44th game. He's finishing his UTSA career on the same field that it began back in 2013. Straight up the gut, they go to Gibson, and he is just shy of the 40. That was the line to gain. And this is going to set up a fourth down and very short here.
You're going to go for it. You're not going to punt into that win. You just punted one all the way in the end zone and cost yourself an opportunity. You need to run the ball and control the clock and run some clock into the wind.
Bob DeBess in his fifth year, former assistant at TCU and Minnesota and A&M and Purdue and Sam Houston State. Used to be the head coach at Texas State when Mack was coaching down at Texas. They met a couple of times.
Good man and knows what he's doing with his offense. Knows it as well as anybody in the country.
A very good fourth down team, one of the best in the country. New Mexico unable to get the conversion. A huge UTSA stop Marcus Davenport, who almost ended up going to New Mexico, opted to stay home at UTSA, and he drills. Well, Brian Urlacher played at New Mexico from 97 to 99. I remember him as the Lobo. That was the new position that Rocky Long put in for a 3-3-5 defense that not many people had seen a ton of over the course of the years. And then not only was a great defensive back and linebacker, but he returned punts, he returned kicks. He would carry the ball once in a while. He had 6 touchdowns on catches. He returned 5 kicks for TDs. And Brian Urlacher, me growing up in Chicago, I was always a fan of him, and we're very pleased to have you in the booth with us, man. Really appreciate
Happy
you taking the time.
I'm glad the Lobos are in a bowl game again. This is exciting.
Back-to-back bowl games for New Mexico, just the 4th time in program history.
Oh, nice play.
And a great play charging in for New Mexico's defense by Jacob Gergel, the safety, a guy who kind of fits that mold. This is a different defense than from what you played under Rocky, obviously, but there are a lot of guys on this defense that still look up to you and want to play like you do. What does that mean to you?
It's awesome. You know, not a lot of kids come to New Mexico. It's hard to recruit here because we haven't won in a while. It's great what Coach Davey's doing. Dakota Cox, you mentioned him earlier, Coach. He's a tough kid. You know, this is his 4th year. He's had over 100 tackles every year.
Loves you.
Yeah.
Looks up to you.
You know, I like him now, too. No.
Thank you.
It's been fun to watch the last couple seasons.
2nd down and 12 for Sturm and the Roadrunners.
There you go.
Trying to power forward, and Rhodes will pick up yardage to the 46-yard line. 3rd down and 5 coming up here.
These guys are really good, Brian, on 3rd down and 5, because you take all the things you saw in the pros. They use the rub routes. They use the pig routes. They use a little boot or naked. What would you tell a linebacker when you're on a 3rd down and 5? What did you look for when you had all this stuff that they throw at you?
The pick routes, like you said, the number one thing. That's a huge thing now, especially in the pro level. And on their first 4th down here, UTSA ran a pick route on the other end, and Dakota got picked there a little bit. They're tough to defend because you got to go over the top, and then you're probably going to make the tackle for a first down.
We said they call them rubs on offense. You call them picks on defense. They run into you.
They're illegals. That's right.
Well, remember that Frank Selfo, the offensive coordinator, spent the last 3 years as a QB coach for Gus Bradley in Jacksonville, worked with Blake Bortles as well. Famer for New Mexico in the booth with us here.
And Adam, if you're Brian, you're looking at a wide split to the top, right. So it could be one-on-one route, or you could go back and see the him sprint that way.
Reverse. Fake.
And keep the ball.
And they fake the reverse with Sturm, and he's got the first down.
Really good call.
That was a great play. Yeah,
great
good call.
Play.
Now, Brian, you were talking about this, the pick route, the rub route, that is so difficult to defend against. If you're Dakota Cox, the guy in the middle of the defense, what are you trying to do to defend this?
It's labeled wrong, first of all. He's got to widen out. See the receiver trying to pick him and either run through him or go over the top. You know, it's going to be a first down probably either way, but maybe get a penalty drawn on the guy.
Again, if you need the contact to have the penalty called, if you're going to run a pick route, that's the way to do it.
Make
them
call it. Yep, a good tackle right there.
That's a good.
And Brian would have watched enough film during the week that he would know this was coming.
I mean, you got to have a little bit of awareness. I would think Dakota saw that. Maybe he was a different. Maybe they're playing inside man coverage instead of outside. Who knows? There's a lot of different things that could have been happening there.
Mac, you asked Brian an interesting question. How was the process coming to New Mexico? Why was it important for you to be at New Mexico?
Well, it's good for recruits to hear this, that maybe not have as many offers right now as they want.
Lobos are the only school that recruited me. The only school that offered me a scholarship, so it was pretty easy decision for me. Coach Franchione told me, he goes, we have a scholarship for you. You can take it now or give it to somebody else. So I said, well, I'll take it. Yeah, no problem. Thanks,
pretty,
Coach.
Pretty simple conversation.
Would you like to talk about it?
Easy.
Don't you wish it was that easy for you?
Yes. Period.
Good play.
It is Rhodes on the ground, and he gets stuffed after a short gain. It'll set up 3rd down here. Obviously, you had a great career with Chicago as well, and I got a chance to see you growing up and seeing you professionally and calling some of your games. What do you miss most about it? I mean, tomorrow is going to be a day where it's going to be frigid.
Freezing.
It's a Packers-Bears game. It's going to be negative temperatures, but what do you miss? Do you miss days like that?
I don't miss the weather. I do miss my teammates and getting ready for games. Our fans were great. The cold weather was great. Our fans came out no matter what. I miss that. Soldier Field on Sundays was great no matter who we played, but Green Bay was really special every time we played. You can throw the records out for those games because it didn't matter what the records were for either
team.
Brian's
got a little pullover. He's not even cold today.
I'm wearing a big coat.
Oh, no, this could be good for them.
On the move, trying to push forward as Williams may have gotten a face mask, and a flag did come flying in from the near side of the field.
And it can show you with instincts and his visualization. Brian saw that was going to be a first down on when they pitched it.
I wish I could see it when I played.
You got a little better spot
it's
up here.
It's pretty nice to watch from up here. Right?
Personal
you guys
foul.
See everything coming.
Face mask. Defense, number 4. 15-yard penalty added to the end of the run. First down.
It's the San Antonio native playing for New Mexico, I.B. Brown. from the cornerback spot. Pretty easy call.
Very definitely.
But a right call.
Made a good play. Kept him inside. Just reached and grabbed the face mask. Brian, what did Wynn do to you when you were playing offenses? Did it limited what they did so much with Wynn like today?
Yeah, you load the box up for the run. And against the Lobos, you do it either way because they're going to run the ball. You know, you got 20 plays, 20 runs so far, I think, for the Lobos. So you just load the box up. If they beat you throwing the football, then they're better than you or they made a good play.
Williams is the lone back. Run blitz here from New Mexico. And trying to find space is Williams. He works his way close to the 9-yard line.
These guys are good on offense. I didn't realize how good they ran the football.
They run the ball well. They've got two backs in Williams and Rhodes that are just the same
quick.
Guy.
Yeah,
they're quick. They're powerful. They're patient up inside. Sturm does a good job running the offense. He's confident.
And I feel like you would appreciate a guy like Dalton Sturm, a walk-on who didn't have a whole lot of opportunity to go to college. He becomes the starting quarterback. I feel like that's somebody you would appreciate.
That's awesome. I watched him play this season on, I don't remember what week it was, on TV earlier in the season. And, of course, you appreciate guys like that. They worked hard, and they got to a successful spot.
His man of the offense on second down and three. Right back to Williams, and he slips down. They'll be marking him shy of the line to gain. The line to gain is the six, so third down and short coming up here. And a big play right now in this first half. You already got the sense. You've been pointing it out a couple times, Brian. This feels like a big play. This feels like a big play. So far, just 7-3. It's a tight one so far.
It is tight, but they feel like they've made the big play so far. The third down and shorts, the fourth and five, you know, they converted on the fourth down stop earlier. They've made the big play so far. It's time for Lobos to make some.
Third down and two.
They've been running the ball successfully. Looks like it could be a sprint left, but I would think he hands it off.
Oh, my.
And it is Williams getting hit shy of the goal line, but it will be first down and goal. Kimmy Carson made the stop, but UTSA gets a fresh set of downs at the shadow of the goal line.
This is a play that Brian made a living on. It's the isolation left, just lead with the fullback. He kicks out and turns it up inside. These guys are good power runners. And Frank Selfo's on a roll. Offensive coaches that get on a roll, they start repeating successful plays.
We got a penalty.
And they know what they're doing.
Yeah, they've
got some good running plays so far. Hopefully
really
it's on,
good.
On the other team.
Illegal substitution. Offense, number seven came in and then went out again. It's a 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
But it'll still be first down and goal. Kerry Thomas Jr. was basically the 12th man on the field, and then he left. So illegal substitution is the call against Frank Wilson's team.
And this started when they started all the substitution with all the different formations and
the
trying to deceive.
Tempo.
Yes, because they're trying to make it clear to the defense to find out exactly who's out there so you know what personnel to match up with. And number two, who you're going to cover.
The college game has changed so much with the personnel changes and the tempo. You watch Oklahoma run some plays, and my goodness, they go fast, and they got guys running on off the field. It's confusing sometimes.
This is kind of nice for us. We get to talk about these teams a little bit, and we get to wait between
huddle.
Plays.
It's nice.
It's a whole new thing, man.
Yeah.
10th play of this drive coming. 9 runs so far for UTSA. And a penalty marker comes in at the end of the play clock.
Delay of game.
There you go.
Offense. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
So again, moving a little bit backwards right now is UTSA.
That's two killers. You can't have a substitution issue when you're going in to score, and then you can't have a delay of game for sure. So Dalton's been around. We're bragging on him. Can't have delay of game with quarterback.
Well, we started up Capital One Bowl Mania today. It continues Friday, December the 30th, the Capital One Orange Bowl. Jim Harbaugh, number 6, Michigan, taking on number 11, Florida State at Hard Rock Stadium in Miami, part of Capital One Bowl Mania, 8 Eastern on ESPN. The talent level in that game, very high. Sturm, under pressure, throws towards the end zone, and it's incomplete, out of bounds. It'll bring up second down and goal. I'd be curious if you've seen a Michigan, a Florida State, any of the bigger teams that are going to be in some of these huge bowl games. Who's impressed you watching some college football on your weekends?
I love college football, so I watch as many games as I can. Michigan's good. Gosh, they're big on both sides of the football. They got speed. You know, usually the Big Ten doesn't have a lot of speed. Michigan has speed. Ohio State has speed. You talk about the SEC when you talk about speed players, but they have both at Michigan, Ohio State. Of course, Alabama is just, they're good. They're good.
Second down and goal, and Sturm will empty it out here.
Could be quarterback draw, or he's throwing a fade.
A quick one that was deflected. He was looking for Kerry Thomas Jr., and that ball was batted near the line of scrimmage.
Coach, those penalties got to drive you crazy as a coach.
They really do. A late flag.
Yep.
That was on you.
That's on. Yeah, no.
Dakota Cox was there to deflect that one. That was on its way to Kerry Thomas. Sturm is struggling 2 for 11.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, offense, number 68, a 15-yard penalty, the down counts, it'll be third down.
Austin
Pratt.
That's
the first unsportsmanlike foul for number 68.
And the coaches told us yesterday, he is aggressive, he is tough. That time it got the best of them a little bit. Yeah,
and they said sometimes that's good, and there's other times that it may be a little bit over the top. And I'm sure that Austin was frustrated with the two penalties, too. He's such a good player and a tough player for them.
Remember, this was first and goal, at the 1 yard line, and penalties have forced him all the way back to third and goal at the 25.
Let's get a takeaway, Lobos.
Like Brian was pretty decent at that in his day. I remember it well.
I'm a huge homer, obviously, as I'm talking to you guys.
We brought a New Mexico Hall of Famer in. Sturm will rifle, and it is caught but shy of the goal line.
Oh, targeting.
And a penalty marker does come flying in. Catch was made by Jabryce Taylor. And Daniel Henry is down to the deck.
Brian, this is a new rule, too.
Yes, it
is. Since you played with targeting it. What are your thoughts on?
Oh, coach, this is I do like the fact in college that they go back and review the play and they pick the flags up if it's not targeting. I wish I'd do that in the NFL. They review
personal
everything
foul.
Else in the NFL.
Targeting. Let's... Number 14 on the defense.
So
half the distance to the goal, automatic first down. The previous play is under further review.
So obviously it's a fresh set of downs, first down for UTSA because of the Henry targeting penalty. And there is no other penalty. It's no personal foul for unnecessary roughness. So if they pick this flag up, that would negate the penalty completely. And there would be no first down because they didn't signal for another penalty with targeting.
Brian, what do you think?
Well, I don't know. It's hard to tell. He'll hit him in the chest and his head just popped back. But doesn't have to be overwhelmingly conclusive to take the flag away in college. I'm not sure.
I would agree. No, it does have to be. You have to have clear evidence that it was not leading with the crowd and an indicator of a launch or making forcible contact above the shoulder pads, you could argue that that could be picked up.
Yeah, I hope they pick it up, personally.
Davey's with you. I think he hopes it's picked up, too.
Well, they'll get it right. They don't really mess these up too much, especially with the review.
Well, I'm glad that Daniel's up. Yeah. I would say they pick it up because it looked like it was on the side and it wasn't. Go ahead, Adam, read the rule to the fans.
This is for those who are, they're getting much more familiar with it, but there needs to be a lead with the crown of the helmet with some kind of indicator of a launch or a target, and it has to be above, or I should say, and or it has to be forcible contact above the shoulders. Now, again, there was no other penalty called by the referee. It wasn't personal foul, unnecessary roughness with targeting. This was strictly a targeting penalty. So if this gets taken off the board, and there's certainly a chance for it to be taken away, there's no ejection for Henry, there's no penalty, and it ends up being fourth down near the 10-yard line.
I don't like the suspension that goes along with this. I mean, the guys aren't doing, this is not malicious. You know, if they keep uphold the penalty, the guy shouldn't be ejected from the game and part of the next. That really drives me crazy as well.
And I don't like it. And Brian, I don't like the fact we send them in.
Yeah, I mean, it's embarrassing. First of all, they made a penalty that hurt their team. It's embarrassing for the kid that were off the field. If there's malicious penalties, I get it. But this is not malicious.
Well, and if Daniel Henry's out of the game, he's one of the best football players.
Yes, he is.
For the Lobo defense. So he's a leader. He's tough. He's smart.
Now, I would venture to say that our replay crew, this is, remember, a Sun Belt Conference replay crew
after
and officiating
review,
crew. It might be overturned.
Number 14 did not target on the play.
Call.
There is no foul. It'll be fourth down.
This is points off. It could be points off the board, too.
Absolutely.
First and goal from the 5. Signal. That's the 4th and 10 from the 11 or whatever it is.
Absolutely.
So Bob Cusera is the replay official. For those who didn't hear it, again, without the penalty flag, the play stands as it was played out. So it's a tackle made at the 10-yard line. It's fourth down now. UTSA is going with the win, and they will bring out their kicker, Victor Falcone. So a lot to sort out on that particular play, but I think the officials got it right.
And you love it being reviewed, like Brian said. He would have been out of the game.
Yeah.
And then tomorrow we say, oh, we missed it.
Yeah, they send you like, oh, we're sorry we missed that play.
Yeah,
that doesn't do us any good now.
A chance to play in your last game.
So a 28-yard try for Victor Falcone is good. And that will be points for UTSA with 92 seconds for the half. Brian, thank you so much.
Thank
really
you.
Appreciate you taking
it.
Some
was
time
fun.
On
thank
for
you.
Us.
Thank you, Coach. Thank you. Appreciate
y'all. New Mexico Hall of Famer Brian Urlacher, his number 44, retired here in Albuquerque. His team up by one. Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and Josh Norman gets to take on his former team. Monday Night Football, starting with Monday Night Countdown, presented by Applebee's. And on first down, it is Lamar Jordan running into Ben Cain. Works his way for 5 to the 30-yard line. Two timeouts remaining for New Mexico on this drive. And earlier in this game, Tyrone Owens on a fourth down play for New Mexico got stacked up by Marcus Davenport and ended up getting tended to by the training staff. Got rolled up on and what looked to be a very, very tough play for him. So Richard McCorley is expected to even be a bigger factor as this game goes on. Michael Iguagu there on the stop. Let's go down to Dawn Davenport. She has more on Owens.
Yeah, they were actually looking at that left foot, the top of the left foot. They took off his shoe. They then retaped it, but he couldn't even move here on the sidelines. The head trainer, Bob Waller, told me he's questionable at best, but he's having trouble walking, guys. I'm not sure we're going to see him again.
Now, remember, Dawn, too, that he didn't play against Wyoming a couple of weeks back because of a foot injury that he suffered against Colorado State the week prior. So that has been something that has been bothering him significantly the last couple of weeks. It is a keep for Jordan. And Lamar Jordan takes it to the 48-yard line. Two timeouts still remain here for New Mexico. They were really in no hurry going against the wind.
Timeout. New Mexico. Run. That's their second timeout of the half. This will be a 30-second timeout.
So their fans to know that's the 23rd play for New Mexico, the 23rd run.
They haven't passed the ball once in the first half.
And it was important. They snapped the ball with 24 seconds left. They could have been forced to punt into the wind there if UT San Antonio had called a quick timeout, which Frank Wilson would have done. So that was a huge first down, whether they get points out of it or not.
If nothing else, it's helpful for field position at the end of the half. And again, short punts at the end of the half, significant plays could happen in a very short time because of field position with the wind playing havoc on this game.
And New Mexico gets the ball to start the second half. So they'll get the ball in the third quarter. So they're not going to take chances here very much. They may throw a ball deep at the end, but they're throwing with an average passer into a horrible wind. So it's not their deal. It's not their game. They might take a deep shot just for the heck of it with 11 seconds left and then try to kick a field goal.
Whistle before the
timeout,
play.
UTSA. It's their final timeout of the half.
You wonder if maybe they
thought... It'll be a 30-second timeout.
That could be a potential pass play.
Absolutely.
And they wanted to make sure that they were prepared in case they did take a shot there.
There's two wide receivers to the top of the screen, to the field, to the quarterback's right. And normally that would be a wheel route or a double move. And I'm sure what Coach Wilson's doing is just give them a little reminder. Okay, guys, keep them in front of you.
More bowl games coming up as Capital One Bowl Mania kicks off today. I don't know why that guy isn't wearing a shirt. Appalachian State and Toledo, good offensive teams there, especially Toledo, one of the best in the country. Southern Miss out of Conference USA, Louisiana Lafayette always brings in a great crowd to the Superdome for the Arnell Carriers New Orleans Bowl. And Central Michigan will take on Tulsa in the Miami Beach Bowl as well.
And these players think this is the playoff for them. This is their national championship game, so I love watching these teams play in bowls.
New Mexico with a one-point lead, closing out the opening half of the first bowl game at the FBS level of 38 coming up. Indeed, it is a pass. Jordan shuffling around and will throw a duck to Terrion Gibson, and he will get out of bounds, which saves New Mexico a timeout. They have a first down here with one timeout remaining. Now, although there is only 4 seconds remaining in this game, or in this half, rather. Gibson,
they're going to kick the field goal into the wind.
They'll give it a shot from 52 yards out. This would be a career long for Jason Sanders, who's been one of the best kickers in the country this year, kicking into that win. And Jason Sanders launching one, and Jason Sanders drilled it for a career long at the end of the first half.
That's the end of the first half.
How pumped was Bob Davey for his this game? It is brought to you by Jared, the Galleria of Jewelry, and that Sanders field goal closed it out. The three penalties came at crucial times on a crucial drive for UTSA. Again, the rushing yards, as we expected with the win, were a major factor. Passing yards, not as much as we get set for the start of the second half. And you did hear Bob Davey tell Dawn Davenport during halftime, during our Buick halftime report, that maybe the wind is starting to die down a little bit, but with the swirling gusts that we've seen so far today, anything can happen here in the next 30 minutes of game time. It certainly doesn't seem to be, based on the visuals that we get a look at with the jackets and the clothing being blown away. It doesn't seem like it's slowing down anytime soon here in Albuquerque.
I think Coach Davey was wishing and hoping that it was dying down.
I know nobody cares about, you know, what we're doing after this, and that's okay. But just to make the point, we have a flight to Denver. It is canceled already because the wind is that much of a factor already. You see the wind at 25. It's gusting up to about 40, 45 miles an hour, and it's making that temperature feel a lot cooler.
And it's also interesting UTSA decided to kick into the wind in the third quarter so they can have the ball in the fourth.
That'll go out of the back of the end zone. Out to the 25 comes New Mexico, and we go down to the sideline in Dawn Davenport.
Find some composure and poise, especially when you're in the red zone. That was the message that head coach Frank Wilson delivered to his team at the half. Now, UTSA has rushed for 144 yards. They're winning time of possession. They've been able to move the football, but coach pointed out to me they've dropped four passes, and that is the problem. He told his team that they cannot self-destruct this half. They have to learn how to finish.
That's a great point, Don. Again, we talked about the penalties, but those four drop passes came at crucial times. They had a chance to move the chains a couple of times, could have extended drives. So from the 25-yard line, the triple option offense of New Mexico goes back to work, and Terrion Gibson is pushed out for a loss of a yard by Nate Gaines, the safety. The best rushing offense in the country is New Mexico. Remember what Don told you in the second quarter about Tyrone Owens was dealing with a foot injury a couple of weeks back. Questionable to return at best after getting hurt in that first half.
And Pete Golding, the defensive coordinator at UTSA, told us it's really hard to prepare for the option in practice. They've gotten the first half down now. It looked like they made some adjustments at halftime and had safety gains coming up to make a good stop on the option.
And Mac, just to put a bow on that thought, it is official. Owens is out for the remainder of this game with that injury. Jordan off the play fake, and we'll throw a little floater to McCorley. And McCorley with a first down and more, breaking tackles and spinning near midfield. Out to the 49-yard line. Picks up 25 yards.
When you know you're not going to have the wind in the fourth, you got to score some points in the third. So Bob DeBest comes out. Second play, they're stopping the option. So he fakes it up inside to McCorley, and then he leaks out. Nobody's there to get him. Really good play on second down in the passing game for the Lobos.
And for McCorley, that's just his fifth career reception. Three of them have come in the last two games for New Mexico.
Once again, when they call you Rock, you run short yards and go on. You don't catch balls.
Darryl Chestnut and Daquan Woodhouse are both in the game in the backfield with Gibson. Jordan's going to take a deep shot, and fluttering that up there ends up with a flag thrown as Matt Corles was going down the field with Devron Davis. We'll see if it's holding or pass interference.
Pass interference, defense, number one. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Oh, Davis, a junior from Stockton, California, will get tagged with it.
When you make those adjustments and you put eight in the box, you're covering everybody one-on-one outside. And the coaches yesterday from New Mexico said we have to win the one-on-ones in the passing game. And the UTSA guys said that's the difference in this game. Can our corners hold up in the one-on-one deep pass?
Well, straight up with the dive, looking for Woodhouse, and he's down to the 33-yard line.
Adam, at halftime, a lot of things happen with coaches. You go first and you talk to the whole group as the head coach. Then the offense, defense, special teams get together individually. Then they go meet their players individually. And then they all come back together and the head coach sends a message. Obviously, at halftime, Bob Davey and Bob DeBest said, we're going to have to loosen it up and throw the ball some downfield in this second half. And especially score some points in the third quarter because we're going to be running into the wind in the fourth.
Jordan will keep it, and he'll get hit at the 31-yard line by Josiah Talaefa. We'll bring up third down here. Again, the pass game is not necessarily anything you're going to hear a ton from for New Mexico. They don't lead on it by any means. The completion percentage for both Austin Apodaca and Lamar Jordan, the two quarterbacks that have been used all year, isn't going to blow anybody away. But Jordan today has completed both of his passes for 43 yards, and he had that pass interference penalty a few plays ago to help move the ball downfield. They're down and five. Jordan against the rush has to get to the 26 and does. First down, Lamar Jordan and New Mexico. The shiftiness, the running ability, coming off his best career game running the football against Wyoming.
They've thrown a few pass plays now, so he's got quarterback draw. Drop back, look like you're going to throw it. Find a spot up inside. They said tackling in space would be so tough, but Jordan Moore can't come up with a tackle against Lamar Jordan. What a huge first down, because you don't want to have to kick a field goal here. You need to get 7 points in with the win.
New Mexico leads the nation in double-digit yard runs. They already have 10 of them, or rather 7 of them, of 10 or more today. And Lamar's got 74 on the ground. Lamar can pitch it late, and he does, to Gibson. And a good job by UTSA to sniff the play out. Minimal gain, and Iguagu is there for the stop for UTSA. Michael Iguagu, his brother Martin, played football in Texas in 2005 and 2008, 44th career game.
Yes, his brother wasn't quite as good as he is. That's what I'd say. I don't want an older brother to be mad at me, but they're a great family. Obviously, UTSA adjusted to the option some at halftime. They played it very well again. Inside out, stretch it, make them run to the sideline.
Jordan, play fake, is going to take a shot to the end zone, and it is incomplete. Anu Samoye, the redshirt freshman who's got a touchdown grab this year, well defended by Austin Jupe, the former Baylor Bear, who redshirted there and finally getting his chance this year.
This is a really good throw by Lamar Jordan. It's high, it's to the outside. Just a really good play by Jupe to knock it out of his hands right at the end. We're seeing adjustments made by both coaching staffs now at halftime. We're going to see this game get exciting here in the second half.
Austin Jupe redshirted at Baylor in 2013, then transferred and sat out, missed the entire 2015 campaign, finally getting to play this year, and in UTSA's first bowl game comes up with a stop. Jordan on third down. Jordan needs the 11-yard line. It's a foot race there. Did he make it there? Marcus Davenport was chasing him. And this would depend on the spot. The line to gain was the 11-yard line. And Omar get very close.
Yeah, sometimes the best play you can have is a pass play with a quarterback when it's broken down and you've got the ability like Lamar Jordan. Now he's got to get this first down. Know where
you are.
The
ball was fumbled forward and out of bounds. The ball will be returned to the spot of the fumble. It's fourth down.
Yeah, that was a mistake by Lamar. He's got to turn up, plant his foot, get the first down. He sure has to hold on to it. So now this becomes a critical fourth and one or less. And we remember last time they did this, it was a stop up inside. I think you give it to the big guy here again, Adam. You come at him with the rock.
They'll work it with rock. McCorley trying to pound forward and looks like he has enough to move the chains and does. Richard McCorley at 220 pounds at 5'11". Big body in a shorter frame, able to pound forward. Jordan Moore was there for the tackle, but it'll be first and goal for Bob Davie.
And I'm sure the coaches questioned themselves when they handed it off last time to Tyrone Owens, because he's 187 pounds. Give it to the big 220 guy up inside, because that's what he does. That's his M.O. He's going to make the short yardage and goal line plays.
And they extend the drive, typical New Mexico drive, 10-play drive over the first 5 minutes of this second half. Straight up the gut. There goes Gibson into the end zone. The best rushing team in the country got a little help through the air, but they bang it in on the ground. Terrion Gibson.
Ten-point swing. They get the field goal right before the half. They take the ball. They've got the win. They need to score. They run option. They run pass. They spread it out and then hand it off inside on the dive to Terrion Gibson for the touchdown.
So Sanders will have that one blocked. The first time in his career that he is not been able to convert on a point after touchdown, and Kevin Strong came up with the block. He had made 82 in a row. Jason Sanders has his streak come to an end. 82 consecutive points after touchdown converted to start his career. The New Mexico record now done. But the Lobos are hyped, and Sanders will kick it short. A squib kick, and Guidry cannot handle it. He'll pick it up from the 7. And a great decision by New Mexico, because that will pin UTSA back at its own 13-yard line. A lot of things starting to go in New Mexico's favor. And on that last drive, they opened up the playbook a little bit, too.
Yeah, they took momentum into halftime. You get the ball to start the second half. You open up with the option. It doesn't work. And then they fake it to Big McWorley inside. Who thinks the 220-pound guy named Rock's going to get a pass? He catches it inside. He turns up. 25-yard play. They opened up the playbook the second half, and they took it down and scored easily with the win.
And again, that's a big reason why Bob Davie probably decided to go with the squib kick, and it ends up playing in New Mexico's favor with that swirling wind. And now Dalton Sturm starts this drive from the 13-yard line. Nothing there for Jarvion Williams. Kimmy Carson in on the stop. Redshirt junior played his 37th career game.
Yeah, a lot of times you start looking at Kevin Cosgrove, the defensive coordinator. He's going to bring a Carson from linebacker. He's going to bring a safety, a nickel, up around that line of scrimmage and try to stop the run on first down.
Kimmy Carson out of Tulsa. Missed 2013 after knee surgery. He's been a key cog in this defense for Kevin Cosgrove. Good run by Jarvion Williams, and he's got the first down and more. A big burst from the senior out of Converse, Texas, Judson High School zone, with a good run out across the 45 to the 47.
And this should have been a stop at the line of scrimmage, but Martin, number 3, a senior, misses the tackle right here in space, lets him turn up, and what a play for the Roadrunners, because they have got to stay in this game into the win, so they'll have the win in the fourth quarter.
He has the most 100-yard games in the history of UTSA. He's closing in on an 8th career 100-yard game. Kerry Thomas cannot snare it cleanly. Incomplete. That'll bring up second down and 10. We mentioned the safety play for New Mexico as well, as you look at Williams, the school record. Ryan Santos is back out on the field for New Mexico's defense. Remember, he had the targeting penalty in the fourth quarter against Wyoming a few weeks ago, so he was not eligible for the first half of this game. That ball deflected into the air, and Nick Diavonzo got a fingertip on it. It floated down to the deck. Carson was diving for it, as was Thomas. Ends up incomplete.
Yeah, Diavonzo's got a really good motor. They love him as a pass rusher. They looked like they were going to come after him that time, but he backed off a little bit, got the big hand up, because he's a 6'3" guy, senior, bats it up in the air, just nearly intercepted by White. Big third down. Don't need to give the ball back right now with the momentum to the Lobos. Looks like they may come with 4.
A four-man twist up front, but the play is whistled dead with a timeout.
Timeout, New Mexico. That's the first timeout of the half.
We'll step aside as well. 8:40 to play, a big third down coming up for Frank Wilson's offense. Kirky, a lot of great designs. Typically, the folks at the Gildan New Mexico Bowl take us out for a balloon ride. It was hard to do with the weather the way it has been with all the gusting winds. But well,
you could have blown to Denver pretty quickly. That would have been your flight.
We'll blow you back right back to Austin, my friend.
Looks like they're coming after him with all of them.
Good protection for Sturm. It's broken up. Josh Stewart, the intended target, and a great play by the third safety on the depth chart, Stanley Barnwell Jr., the junior college transfer out of Florida.
Kevin Cosgrove gets them all up at the line of scrimmage. He brings them all but one. He's playing man-to-man outside. You've got to win one-on-one situations. As you said, Adam, third team safety covering Josh Stewart. Good stop for the Lobos.
And Dalton Sturm, 3 for 15 for 30 yards. So now you have to punt here. You keep it low with the rugby-style kick to avoid the wind. And a good one knocked there by Giannis Routsis. It'll be down at the 5-yard line. Good decision on the rugby punt. Good coverage by this unit on a 48-yard kick. 8:24 for the third. We will play. Yes. Pinned at their own 4-yard line after a very good Routsis punt. And it will be a Jordan keeper and a good cushion run as we go to Dawn with the wind.
Hey guys, you know Coach Davey told me at the half that he thought the wind was settling down a bit. Yeah, that's wishful thinking. I'm watching officials pick up debris that is heading out onto the field. And actually, Coach Wilson, when I talked to him at half, he told me, I'm not worried about the weather because remember, we are weatherproof. He said he took his guys out. They had some uncharacteristically windy days in San Antonio last week, 40 degrees and windy. And he said his team basically mentally prepared themselves to step into this. So he's not worried about them this half.
It is Jordan on the keep once again here, Don, and that'll set up third down. So again, I know some fans are going, God, why are they talking about this so much? Mac, this affects offensive play calling. I know New Mexico is a typical running team anyway, but this affects play calling, it affects kicking strategy, it affects so many. Pull the curtain back, and this is what the coaches worry about over the course of the game.
They're watching it every moment. We even heard Brian Urlacher say that load the box with the wind, baby, when you're going into it. So it affects defensive play calls, too. You're going to take more chances. And New Mexico's trying to score in this quarter instead of just kill the clock. They need points.
Third down and one. And trying to burst up the middle. The line to gain was the 14-yard line. And McCorley came close. Good stop by Tawa Effa. Let's see where they spot this football. They put it right at the 14-yard line, so this may require a measurement. Instead, the officials will say first down.
But that's a huge first down. Big. Because you're punting into the wind. You get the short field. Frank Wilson could have gotten advantage here, even though he chose to take the win in the fourth quarter. But we got to remember, if they can slow New Mexico down and get to the fourth quarter, UTSA is going to have that win.
And again, what do you talk about when you're pinned deep in your own territory? Get the first down. Now we've got a drive.
First down.
Now New Mexico actually has a drive plan from their own 14. Jordan, not much there. Another good job by this UTSA front of sniffing out an option play. I'll give you this much. I saw the Wyoming game a couple of weeks back. Craig Bowles, an excellent coach, and that's a pretty good defense. They had a lot of struggles with the triple option. UTSA has actually held its own pretty well, and now Jordan is slow to get up.
Yes, when you start looking at having a month to prepare, that helps you. 2-3 weeks, more than just a short week. But also, you also had the advantage of looking at what Wyoming did to make sure that you change some things. And they've gotten their safeties involved a lot more this second half. And Nate Gaines is playing a lot at the line of scrimmage.
But now the concern rests with Lamar Jordan, redshirt junior out of Frisco, Texas. He and Austin Apodaca have both started games this year. Apodaca started the season with 3 starts before he injured his collarbone against Rutgers. Jordan was the starter for the next 7 games. Apodaca started at Colorado State and was relatively ineffective. So Jordan came in. They seemed to move the ball a little bit better. Apodaca got no time against Wyoming because Jordan was running such an efficient offense. But these guys get almost equal reps in practice. They've gotten almost equal time over the course of the season. And Bob Davey and Bob DeBest said, hey, if I got to throw somebody in on a third down and switch quarterbacks, I don't mind doing that. I'm not afraid. We're past hurting feelings at this point. Both of my guys are ready.
But we have to be honest. Lamar Jordan can fly.
Yeah.
He's dynamic. He is their guy for the option. Apodaca is a thrower that runs okay.
Exactly. And that's where the difference lies. He said it's not ideal to have a guy who passes better and a guy who runs better in a 2QB system. But we'll see how Apodaca does. And they're going to go right to the air. And he'll rifle down the middle, and it's incomplete. Q Drennan was the intended target. And a good job by Devron Davis in coverage.
You go back to one-on-one situations. UTSA said, we got to win them. And New Mexico said, we're going to have eight in the box. We know we're one-on-one. We've got to make those plays downfield. Apodaca coming off the sideline. First time, gets the fake of the option, throws it downfield. That's his strength. A little bit behind him. It's interesting they are not bringing Lamar Jordan right back in.
It is Apodaca on third down. New Mexico 5 of 8. Four-man rush. Tawa Effa got blocked. That throw goes short arm to the 30-yard line. They're looking for Damian Gamblin, one of their top targets, and unable to convert on third down.
What a great stop. The wind's picked back up.
Yep.
It's right in their face. If you're UTSA having to come back with an offense, so they've got to get the long punt here and try to set them back and not allow UTSA to have really good field position here. Only 5:46 left with the win for New Mexico in the third quarter.
So Bo Jorquez will kick away. And a fair catch signaled. It's not easy to make those catches, but Jabryce Taylor is there. And decent field position for UTSA on this drive. Well, we're here. Capital One Bowl Mania is upon us, and we'll have a couple more bowl games coming up with the Raycom Media Camellia Bowl, Appalachian State and Toledo. Watch their running backs in that game. If you're looking for stars and guys to kind of latch onto over the course of those games, Kareem Hunt, Marcus Cox are the backs in that game. And then in the Arnell Carriers New Orleans Bowl, Southern Miss, really good quarterback that they have this year, Louisiana Lafayette. Couple more to go on this first day of Capital One Bowl Mania on ESPN. They did give Lamar Jordan his helmet back, as you saw on the sidelines, as UTSA has its best starting field position from the 43. And Sturm breaking tackles, still on his feet. And Dalton Sturm nearly picks up a first down on a play where he could have been sacked, where he could have been hit for a loss, where he could have been hit for a short gain. He ends up muscling for 9 yards.
And Kenny Carson, who we bragged on, missed the tackle that time. But when Dalton Sturm is not having a good day throwing, you got to have him step up as a leader and a tough guy. And he gets out of the pocket and makes people miss him. You've got to have the tackle there if you're number two. Kimmy Carson, good play by Stern.
Run blitz here, and it's a give to Jarvion Williams. And he should have enough for the first down. And he will.
Yeah, Kimmy Carson was mad. He missed the tackle, so he penetrated and nearly hit the guy. Made it a short play for a first down. This is one of the things that Kevin Cosgrove does so well, and he's penetrating against Austin Pratt. Austin picks him up, just didn't quite make the tackle, but got good penetration.
That's the run blitz that we talked about, just kind of racing up to the line to add an extra man against a run. So on first down, it is Williams trying to shift to the outside. Nothing there. And a good second effort by Nias Martin from the cornerback spot. He gets the tackle for loss. Senior out of Baltimore making the play.
And this is an important series because they need to kill the clock because of the win. So if they can kill the clock, get some points, and then get the win for the fourth quarter, it's worked out better for UTSA than it started in this quarter.
We saw Kevin Cosgrove in his fifth season at New Mexico, second year as the defensive coordinator. draw play, and here comes Williams. So that'll set up a more manageable third down and about seven or so from the 42 as Crosby made the tackle on Williams.
That was a good call. You've got delayed draw. Dakota Cox on the blitz runs by him. And the back, Williams, a really good back, good vision, good patience. Cox just runs right by him, and he turns it up inside.
Kevin Cosgrove talked to us about how important third down is going to be today. The former Barry Alvarez assistant on the sidelines as Sturm runs it. Sturm hurdles a man on the deck and has the first down to the 34-yard line. Two good runs from a sneaky athletic quarterback, according to the coaching staff. You don't think of a guy who came in at 165 to be super athletic. He's got a lot of ability that not most people see.
And they're not an option team, but Jarvion Williams on the option cuts Ryan Santos down with a super block on the corner. They blitz from the field. Kevin Cosgrove, good play call into the boundary. First down by Dalton Sturm.
He's got more rushing yards than passing yards in this game.
They're not supposed to be running options. That other bunch.
Adam, that's right.
Slipped one in on them there.
Deep drop for Sturm. Looking at something will develop downfield. Instead, it's Lee Crosby lunging back for the interception. The redshirt senior with his first pick as a New Mexico Lobo.
Watch what Kevin Cosgrove does, the defensive coordinator we were just talking about. He shows blitz with everybody, and then he backs them out, and he really confused Dalton Sturm, gets the safety up underneath, and very good interception. Nickelback Lee Crosby, what a play.
Junior college transfer from Baltimore City.
And I've coached against Kevin Cosgrove. The man knows what he's doing.
Yep.
He knows what he's doing.
You had some battles when he was at Nebraska and you were at Texas. So now New Mexico goes to the ground in McCorley, and it'll pick up about three on this first down run.
Yeah, Kevin was laughing. They were at Nebraska and they came in, blitzed every play. And it finally ended up, we hit a 96-yard run with Jamal Charles, who's pretty fast down that boundary, to win the game 28-24. He said last night, we didn't care. We're coming after you.
Well, good to see Lamar Jordan back on after he took quite the shot in the previous series. They did give him his helmet back when he went to the sideline after some quick examination, and he is back out there starting this drive. On second down, Tarion Gibson somehow staying on his feet. But King Newton, the son of the Pro Bowler for the Dallas Cowboys, Nate Newton, had good penetration on the play, and it'll be a loss of a yard.
Yeah, Trey Newton, King's older brother, played for us at Texas.
That's
he
right.
was a very good running back, and I remember King being a little bitty guy. He's grown into a big guy. He's not any more like his dad now, not like Trey, the running back.
Yeah, Nate won 3 Super Bowls, 6 Pro Bowls with the Cowboys. King's mom played volleyball at Louisiana in the 70s. Trey finished up his career in 2010 at Texas. Third down and 8.
Mom was a school teacher. Good,
yep.
Good folks.
And he's just a redshirt freshman as Newton, part of a 4-man rush with Tala Effa coming late. And Tala Effa getting the sack on Lamar Jordan. A great UTSA stand after the sudden change with the turnover.
Yeah, we're just bragging on Kevin Cosgrove, Pete Golding. Sudden change, you got to come back up. And Tala Effa is a guy that makes plays. You like seeing him. He's all over the place. He's a smart player. He comes this time, and he tackles maybe the quickest and fastest guy on the field one-on-one. What a play.
When we talked with Pete Golding, the defensive coordinator and this UTSA staff, Tala Effa, he's the guy that will impact this game more than any other player against the run and on that particular play against a very good and elusive quarterback. Line drive kick, Jabryce Taylor. A great job on a very low line drive kick by Corey Bohorquez. And the coverage unit was right on top of it. And we're in the final half minute of this third quarter. Of course, this is what we've been leading up to all year long. Washington, Alabama in the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl. Ohio State, Clemson in the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl on ESPN. Saturday, December the 31st, starting with coverage at 3 o'clock Eastern time. Give me one thing that I should look at on both of those matchups.
Well, the first one, you've got to look at turnovers. Unless they can force turnovers against Alabama and protect the ball, Washington can't win. because Alabama's defense is so good.
So Jake Browning has to be very careful in that game against that very good Alabama defense.
He does. Got to be smart, and he struggled in a couple of the big games as of late. And Alabama's not the best defense to get well on.
Yeah, you can't fix your woes against him.
It is really hard.
Quickly, something on Ohio State Clemson before we go to the fourth.
I think that's the game of the year, really, yep. For me. They're both so similar. Both have older quarterbacks that have both been in the Heisman race. They can both run it. I think it's going to end up being who's going to run the ball the best and protect the ball.
That's the end of the third.
Second down for the Roadrunners to start quarter number four. Going to push it with Jalen Rhodes. And a good stop by Stanley Barnwell, who's made two nice plays here in the second half. Again, the third safety on the depth chart, his first year at New Mexico after a transfer from junior college.
His coaching staff's been around a long time for New Mexico. I think Coach said they were seasoned.
Was the word he wanted to use.
Gray experience, whatever it is. But Kevin Cosgrove is going to make Dalton Stern beat him throwing the ball. He is not going to let them continue to run the ball. See a lot more guys in the box.
Toss play for Rhodes, being chased, and Rhodes turning the corner with the first down. Dakota Cox finally caught up to him, but a great job by Rhodes to get away from the initial penetration of William Uday.
Uday's got great penetration. It looks like it's going to be a stop. There's a lot of guys in the box, but Jalen Rhodes shows his speed on the sweep, getting on the corner, and he had a really good block by Shaq Williams out there. Two or three times we've mentioned Shaq's name blocking on the corner.
So Rhodes, who missed all of 2014, came back strong as a redshirt freshman and has had a breakout year with 9 touchdowns, a school record. Sturm will step up and he'll take off. And Sturm gets a block to pick up the first down. Matt Guidry was downfield to open up just enough space for Sturm to slip past the sticks in a first down.
Well, another good play by Sturm. He's struggling in the passing game. So what do? You don't see the guy there. You've got a wheel route downfield. You break the tackle, and you turn it up and run for the first down. This young guy's a winner. He's just trying to fight through his struggles in the passing game. And the wind could have a lot to do with that.
Yeah, it continues to swirl. It continues to gust. You can hear it on our microphones. Gusts up to 40, almost 45 miles an hour consistently at about 25 all day. Draw play for Rhodes. Good penetration by Dakota Cox. 43rd career start today for the senior out of Draper, Utah. Proven toughness for this young man. Excellent middle linebacker.
Yeah, Dakota was actually committed to Cincinnati with Butch Jones and with the changeover when he went to Tennessee. They got him a really good player here. Guy closing in on 400 tackles.
His dad, Tom, was the starting center for USC in the mid-80s. Huge Brian Urlacher fan, and Brian was with us in the second quarter, talked about how much he appreciates Dakota Cox. Got to meet Brian Urlacher when Urlacher had his jersey retired in November of 2013. Play action. Sturm pumps and now takes off, and he'll slide down past the 30. We'll mark him right at the 30-yard line with Maurice Daniels closing in. There's Cox there to help Sturm up after the play.
Well, and Maurice Daniels is their best pass rusher. So you can see that UTSA is using play action pass. They fake the draw that time to try to slow down the pass rush. But you're sitting here at 3rd down and 9. Very critical play. UTSA has got one back in the backfield. They like the rub routes on these situations or screens.
Flag comes in before the play can be run for delay of game.
False start. Offense, number 65.
Uh-huh. Your
5-yard penalty. Still 3rd down.
But I saw the back judge holding up his arms for the play clock winding down. Instead, it's Stephon Beard who got tagged with the false start penalty. Junior out of Chicago, went to high school in Austin, Texas.
Well, and it was also a unique call. They were going to hand the ball off on a dive up underneath. So they're probably going to try to get the first down, but if not, make sure they keep a chance for a field goal here because they've got the win behind them.
They're down in 14 now after that penalty.
They'll be smart here.
Just a 4-man rush, and it will still get to Sturm as he stepped up in the pocket. He went right into the waiting arms of Garrett Hughes. Second team Mountain West Conference selection
Yeah, they describe Garrett Hughes to us as very active, a guy that's got constant energy, and they've got four good pass rushers up front. They said when they got here, they had pretty good linemen, even though it was 3-37 the previous years before this staff came in. But they signed this senior class. They said they're on blind faith, and they're so proud of them. But they said they had to get better with the skill, and Bob Davies done a good job recruiting.
So now it is fourth down here.
Got to get past the chains. You got to hope you get a penalty flag, get something deep. Too deep, probably in the middle.
And Sturm will try to muscle a throw past the sticks, and Brady Jones is able to catch it on the dive at the 16-yard line. On fourth down and 14, they get 19 yards to Jones.
But perfect anticipation. Dalton Sturm steps up into the pockets. It's a two-deep secondary. He throws it over Cox's head, Dakota Cox's head. What a first down on fourth and long.
A clutch catch by Jones, and now a fresh set of downs. Williams, though, runs right into Carson. Good play right near the line of scrimmage by Kimmy. Redshirt junior makes the stop, and it's second down.
And from this point on, we've got 10 minutes and 18 seconds left. We're all going to start looking at this clock. With these two teams running the ball, you look up in a minute, and there's seven left, and then there's five left. Got to make plays.
This feels like, and it doesn't have to be a touchdown, but it feels like it has to be a score no matter what for UTSA, because I'm not kidding when I say this. If you score and you give the ball up to New Mexico, you may not get it back in the fourth quarter. So this is a crucial Roadrunners offensive series. Play action. Sturm into the flat, and it is caught. Legend for the pylon, and a touchdown, Trevor Stevens. The first touchdown for Stevens in his career comes in his 45th game.
They've been running the ball. They fake the run to the backside. They slip the back out in the flat. The guys jump him. Tight end Stevens right behind him. What a throw by Sturm. I'm really impressed with Dalton Sturm on this drive.
Extra point attempt is good from Victor Falcone. Despite the wind pushing that one towards the upright. Trevor Stevens started his UTSA career on this field. The first time UTSA and New Mexico ever UTSA's first bowl game. He gets UTSA's first bowl touchdown ever. And now the sideline is really jacked up in what is now a three-point game.
We got both sidelines jacked up, Adam. They're jumping up and down. They're screaming. People who question bowl games ought to tune in and watch. We got us a game.
Portillo with the kick. Grabbed by Lilly in the end zone, and he'll take a knee. To the 25 will come the Lobo offense.
Very interestingly, in the third quarter, 15 rushes for only 37 yards for the Lobos. They only averaged 2.5 yards a carry. Now they're going into the wind. We have 9:43 left. You got a three-point lead. You're going to have to run the ball. Let's see if UTSA can still stop the option like they did in that third quarter.
Against the best rushing team in the country. So full day of bowl games, and when we're done, SportsCenter at night. Bucci and Briscoe will have all the highlights from the bowl games. Dolphins-Jets Saturday Night Football as well. When that goes final, NBA, NHL, Georgetown-Syracuse played today, NFL news for Week 15, SportsCenter at night after the Arnell Carriers New Orleans Bowl. On the reverse, it's Damian Gamblin, and he gets shut down. Nowhere to go for Gamblin. More good penetration by this front. And it is King once again up front. T.J. King this time out of Irving, Texas.
Now what a play for a redshirt freshman. He looks at the ball going away. He keeps in a good stance. He shuffles. He keeps the reverse up inside. What a play for the young guy on first down. Very good. Very well taught. Very good technique.
Roddy the Roadrunner getting excited. UTSA sidelines getting rowdy. The first-year defensive coordinator Pete Golding looks on. As Jordan Lutz run and finds Gamblin. And Gamblin grabbed by Iguagu finally inside the 45 of UTSA. They lull you to sleep, they lull you to sleep, and then they beat you over the top. That's been a theme for New Mexico this year.
It's nearly unfair. You can see the wind blowing. It's right in his face. Run it, pound it, run it, pound it. And then you have a crossing route to the best receiver for the Lobos. Gamblin for a huge first down.
23 catches for Gamblin to lead the team this year for Bob Davey.
We've got two really good play callers in this ball game. Experienced guys.
Bob DeBess, Frank Selfo, the offensive coordinators in this game. On the pitch to Gibson, to the edge, and hit hard after a short game. The pursuit that time by Jordan Moore. Grad transfer from Atlanta for UTSA's defense.
Still really impressed with Pete Golding's adjustments at halftime. He's gotten the safeties much more involved in coming up and stopping the option. And that's why you saw the pass wide open after play action. And we're probably going to have to see a little bit more wide open play calls here with New Mexico trying to go down and score. And a lot of guys near that line of scrimmage.
Trying to load it up against the run, and good penetration on Gibson there as he's chopped down by Bass at the 39-yard line. Third down, about six here for New Mexico.
And I would think you're in four down territory. You cross the 50, you've got wind in your face, the wind's blowing hard, so you've got two downs to make this first down and keep the ball. And your play call this time is predicated on having two downs to make it.
Yeah, so you're playing four down territory essentially here. Top rushing offense in the country has been relatively stymied by this UTSA defense. Past the halfway point of the fourth quarter. Back to the ground they go, and McCorley spinning forward and looks like he's hit right at the line to gain, which was the 33. It is good enough for a first down.
And that's what I'm talking about with Bob DeBess. It's third and six. He hands the ball off to the rock up inside, and he makes his first down because you've got two downs to get it. So if he made 3 yards, he made 4 yards, he would come up with a fourth and short.
Just as kind of an additional thought, almost a footnote right now, but it may play a factor later. Remember that UTSA has a blocked extra point in this game. It would be 17-13 if not for that blocked extra point. So instead of a touchdown game right now being a four-point lead, it's a field goal game right now. So this is a huge defensive series for UTSA.
And New Mexico needs to get at least three.
Here is Jordan. He can still pitch it. And he does very late to McCorley. Another Gibson. And he's forced out by Iguagu.
That is played so well by UT San Antonio. And they still get yards because of their speed. But Iguagu is a guy who can play in space. Watch him. He comes up. He slow plays him, slow plays him. Lets the safety, Nate Gaines, come inside out. Forces him to the boundary. Uses the boundary as his extra defender. And they get very few yards.
Gap integrity is a phrase we hear a lot from defensive coordinators against triple option offenses. I think the Roadrunners have had a lot of gap integrity.
Yes, discipline, good eye discipline. They have really taken care of their gaps.
Second down and four here. Here is McCorley to the edge. And Iguagu cannot make the stop. McCorley will take it near the 10-yard line as Bass finally runs him down. A 15-yard run.
We talk about Richard McCorley being the big, tough guy inside. This guy's got speed at 220 pounds. Sees it's not there. He bounces out to his outside. Plants his foot, turns it up inside for another first down. What an impressive drive by New Mexico into the wind in the fourth quarter. Let the clock run. 5:34 left. You've got to force a kick if you're UTSA.
Trying to go up the middle with McCorley. About two on the play. Talaiafa part of the tackle there, along with Bass.
Force a kick, you've got plenty of time. But they are letting that clock run, and they're not getting in a hurry.
Clearly within field goal range, and even with the wind today, remember that Jason Sanders hit a 52-yarder in this direction at the end of the first half, a career long. One of the longest in New Mexico Bowl history, and it's 11 years.
Your UTSA knock a ball loose, tip a pass. Got to do something to keep them out of the end zone.
UTSA is plus +3 on the season in turnover margin. Back to the ground and lunging past the 5-yard line is Gibson for a strong run. A couple yards shy of a line to gain, and so it'll be third down and short coming up here.
And you worry a little bit about altitude for UTSA.
5,300 feet above sea level here.
Fourth quarter, 5,300 feet, first bowl game. Bob Davey talked about it. He gave his kids a lot of time off, wanting them fresh for this fourth quarter.
Third down and two.
This is where you love college football.
Yes, sir.
What's he going to do? Is he going to hand it off to Big Rock up inside? Got unbalanced line to the field.
He's got three receivers on the wide side. Now setting a man in motion and giving it to McCorley. Where did he get hit? He can still get a first down at the two-yard line. So this will be a very important spot as well. Will it be fourth down and short? Will it be first down and goal? And it is being marked short. A huge stand by UTSA, and the game very well could come down to this play right now.
And if you're Bob Davey, you have a decision, but you're going to let that clock run as much as you can. I'd probably see him let the clock run and then call timeout with 1 second left, so you got time to think about it. He may want to keep his timeout.
Now he's jogging down the sideline. I'm going to guess that he's going to wait till it runs down. Now, again, some of the play clocks on the field are down.
Timeout, New Mexico. That's their second timeout of the half.
It's frustrating when that official's not watching. Timeout!
If you guys didn't know, Max says we should take a timeout and come back after this break. Huge fourth down coming up. Here at the Gildan New Mexico Bowl in 2007. They were here last year against Arizona. The Wildcats came away with a win. Who'll come out on top today? Whoever it'll be, we'll find out in 3:08. Bob Davey with a crucial decision to try to make here on fourth down. However, we were told before the offense just took the field moments ago that the previous play, the spot, will be reviewed by the replay booth, and you can review a spot if it is involved with a touchdown, scoring play, or the line to gain. And certainly the line to gain was in question here. The line to gain was the 2 yard line as McCorley took it forward. There has to be clear and obvious evidence that he got past the line to gain. Josiah Talaefa seemed to be there with a big stop shy of the 2 yard line. I think the officials got it right on the first try.
I do too. So if you're Coach Davey, you've got four decisions you can look at. Number one, you kick the field goal. Number two, you try to draw them off sides. Number three, you run it to Big Rock. Number four, you put it in Lamar's hands for option. That's what you're talking about on the sideline right now.
I know this down and distance, maybe not fourth down necessarily, but this distance has sometimes been thought of as a play action distance. I don't see that.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. The runner was short of the line to gain. It is fourth down.
I don't see play action here for New Mexico.
Now, when you're the best rushing team in America, you do what Coach Royal said, the old coach at Texas, you dance with the one that brung you. So it's either going to be Big Back, Big Rock, it's going to be Richard McCorley, or it's going to be Lamar Jordan, one of the two.
Here we go. Fourth down and short. McCorley on the left, Gibson on the right of Lamar Jordan. It is McCorley. He got hit at the 1 yard line. It is a first down though. So it will be a fresh set of downs for New Mexico. But what a stop at the goal line at the very least to prevent the touchdown for UTSA. And now you're getting close to the 3 minute mark and ducking inside of it.
Give it to your big guy. And we've got a great block with 88, the tight end, Nick Lehman, up inside as well. But the big boy gets hit. He turns. He rolls his pads in for the first down.
Talaefa was there for the stop. Although they have first down and goal at the one, this almost kind of helps them a little bit because they can run a little bit more clock now and potentially score a touchdown. Roadrunners do have all three of their timeouts. Those may become crucial.
You see Lamar Jordan standing. He's letting it get down to about 3 seconds left.
Right up the gut, trying to pound forward, and it is a touchdown for Richard McCorley, his second of the day. And touchdown number 25. In his career, this is just his second year at New Mexico. 25 touchdowns.
When you get in a tight spot like they have throughout the day on short yards and goal line, you do what you do best. You give it to your 220-pound back from Meridian, Mississippi, Richard McCorley, because he's protecting the ball and he's making positive yards.
And now Sanders on for the extra point in what is now a two-score game. 2:22 left, still all three timeouts, but New Mexico takes 7 minutes and 21 seconds off the clock. Bob Davies' team is on top. He's leaned on Richard McCorley a lot in his two. Before Bob Davie got here, when Mike Locksley was the head coach, they had some rough seasons. He wanted the job that fit him at the right time, in the right place. His family is acclimated well here. His son is on staff. His daughter is a lawyer in town. This was the right place at the right time for Bob Davie. And his team is 220 away from a major win in its program's run in the last decade plus, as Matt Guidry takes it out to the 20-yard line. Game certainly not over just yet. Three timeouts in a two-score game with UTSA having the football. Remember that the Capital One post-game trophy ceremony will follow this game immediately over on ESPN3, so you'll be able to see the presentation of the Most Valuable Player Award as well as the trophy presentation. And it is a very unique that's a dumb thing to say. Nothing can be very unique. It is a unique trophy. It is one of a kind.
I think it's very unique.
No, you can't. Unique means one of a kind. You can't be very unique.
It's beyond unique.
Sturm over the middle. That play gets broken up. Kimmy Carson has made some clutch plays today, and Marquez McNair got ripped down before he could corral it cleanly.
Yeah, now you're going to keep him in front of you if you're the defense for the Lobos. If you're the offense, you're Frank Selfo. They're going no backs. They're 1 minute tempo with 2:10 left. You've got to score fast.
Pressure getting to Sturm, even with the rush at just four. Dumps it off for Brady Jones. He's out at the 29-yard line, so the clock will move as it shied the line to gain. Dakota Cox was there for the stop.
And then talking to Bob Davie, I thought he's having fun. He's got a staff he likes. They are older. You always need to have a lawyer in the family if you're a coach. So good to got your son on the staff. Fun time for him.
Straight up the middle. Good run here for Jarvion Williams. And Williams works into Lobo territory to the 49-yard line. Huge run, an important run. It stops the clock to move the chains.
It's never over till it's over. The fans might say, this one's done, but they can onside kick after they score and get the ball back quickly.
Need to get into the end zone, or you could opt for a field goal. I doubt they would at this point, though. Throw to the sideline, leaping catch by Kerry Thomas Jr. And he gets ripped down by Lee Crosby inbounds, so the clock will move unless the Roadrunners use a timeout.
Second down, timeout, UTSA. That's their first timeout of the half.
We'll take timeout as well. A minute 22 remaining in a two-score game. This is unique. This is one of a kind. This is sui generis. This is the trophy that is given to the winner of the Gildan New Mexico Bowl, Native American clay pot, handcrafted by Marcellus and Elizabeth Medea from the Zia Pueblo tribe. The Zia Pueblo is a tribe that is based here in New Mexico, or centered here. The outstanding defensive and offensive players get that handcrafted piece, and then the trophy, 20 inches of Zia Pueblo pottery, is awarded to the winner. Out of a timeout, flag is thrown.
False start, offense, number 4, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
Marquez McNair, and I don't think there's a whole lot in the upset your coach manual than getting a false start penalty out of a timeout.
Can't have pre-snap penalties. Kevin Cosgrove shifted his defense very quickly, and Marquez just jumped off. Got to be focused.
So now second down, Sturm over the middle, and it's caught. First down inside the 30 for Kerry Thomas Jr. Finally brought down at the 28-yard line. Nias Martin made the stop. That's a gain of 20 yards for the junior out of College Station, Texas. He and his brother Josh Stewart are the leading receivers on this UTSA team. They may have to be factors in the final 70 seconds. Sturm under pressure and just floats it away. Penetration and pressure from Austin Ocasio. He was out of the pocket and got it past the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, the defensive coaches obviously thought they were being too passive, so they had to come after them. Good call on defense.
New Mexico with a 10-point advantage, 103 to play in the fourth. Second down and 10 coming up for Dalton Sturm in the Roadrunner offense.
We know what UTSA has to do. We're not sure. We're going to see a lot of changeups with the Lobo defense. Looks like they're bringing three. Going to bring five now, maybe seven.
Well, they're showing a lot of pressure. They're bringing some of it. Sturm is able to get it off pretty cleanly, but Jabryce Taylor couldn't extend high enough on a tall throw. That'll bring up third down and 10. The Lobos have had a great performance today from Richard McCorley. He is today's Capital One player of the game with his two rushing touchdowns. He has been a touchdown machine in his 2 years at New Mexico. 25 on less than 200 carries. He also had a big 25-yard reception in the third quarter as well.
And he protects the ball.
Yep. Third down and 10. And a misfire on the snap, but flags come flying in.
Illegal snap on the offense. Number 68. 5-yard penalty. It's still third down.
Austin Pratt. I imagine there was probably some movement of the ball before the snap, and that might have been why there was a bit of a misfire on it going back to Sturm.
Ball's pretty cold in this wind late in this ball game, too. Hands are cold.
So now third down, needing to get to the 18-yard line. Less than a minute to go and two timeouts. Just a four-man New Mexico rush. Sturm looking. Sturm floating it down the field, and Marquez McNair is unable to haul it in. It's ruled incomplete, but flags come in after the play. Kerry Thomas Jr. was also coming down in the area of the ball and got tripped up, and he is a little slow to get up after the play. Now back up on his feet. And then McNair ended up diving towards the ball and nearly snaring it off the deck.
Pass interference. Defense, number 27. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
When the spread set, you bring in extra defensive backs. Bijan Parker, the sophomore out of Los Angeles, gets tagged with the penalty. And again, he ended up just making some contact there. I don't think it was Parker. I think it should have been called on Gurgle. It should have been 16, because he was the one who made the contact with Thomas, unless they're saying that Parker...
The ruling on the field was of an incomplete pass. The previous play is under further review.
Unless they were saying Parker was impeding McNair's progress, then perhaps that's why you call the pass interference there. Now you have to review the play as well, whether or not McNair made the catch. And he wasn't necessarily even the intended target on the play.
And it probably really doesn't matter which one interfered, except for the mother. It matters to mom, let me assure you.
But I feel like you've heard this before.
Yes.
Who's this number from? Why am I getting called by my safety? Hey, either way, regardless of who impeded the progress, and I thought for a second it was more Gurgle on that play, and you could even rule that it was incidental more than anything else. But now the most important thing is there clear and obvious evidence that this is a catch by McNair as he was trying to go across the goal line just shy of it?
Well, and at what point do you take the field goal, knowing you've got to have 10 points to tie the game anyway, and you can't run the clock out here?
Now, they're going to obviously stand with the penalty here, so you're at the 17-yard line, essentially, at this point. So you're looking at about a 35-yard field goal to try to get one of the two necessary scores to stay alive in this game.
After
if you're
review, the ruling on the field of an incomplete pass is confirmed. Incomplete. First down after the enforcement of the penalty.
So, again, I think that was well officiated by Bob Kusser in the replay booth and this Sun Belt Conference crew. It will be first down from the 18-yard line. 48 seconds and two timeouts remaining for UTSA. The clock does stop because it was a penalty. And, yeah, I wonder, I mean, do you take a shot to the end zone right away? Because, again, it's a two-score game no matter what.
You've got to, you can't waste time. You can't throw underneath the chains. You got to go for the end zone now. You can't take a run. You can't take a screen. You've got to score fast.
Pressure coming from New Mexico. Sturm will throw underneath to Thomas. One-on-one on the outside. Thomas will take it to the five. He's got the first down at the 4. That stops the clock to reset the change. Still 2 timeouts for UTSA. The clock will move on the referee's signal.
And Brown misses the tackle in space. And if they tackle him, the clock's going to continue to run and force a timeout. Really good play by Kerry Thomas.
The UTSA will try to take advantage here on first and goal from the 4. To the end zone, and it is Jabryce Taylor hauling it in for a UTSA touchdown. And the Roadrunners, with 25 seconds to go, are still alive in this game. 2nd touchdown of the year. The other one came against Arizona State. His 2nd comes in the bowl game.
And you're putting 6'2 on 5'11 in the corner with a fade for the touchdown. Good call by Frank Selfo.
Now a crucial extra point here to make it a 3-point game. And indeed, Falcone is true. And now it is onside kick time for UTSA to try to get the ball back. As Jabryce Taylor, the senior out of Lufkin, Texas, the junior college transfer after a year at SMU, hauls it in.
And we have to remember, nobody is going to work on onside kicks full speed. It's too dangerous in practice.
Okay.
So it's one of the reasons when that crazy oblong ball is bouncing all over the place that we see onside kicks work. Most of the time, if the kicker has a high bounce, it's over. Game's over. He'll get it. But this is a crucial play, and I can promise you that Bob Davies' stomach is churning. And good job by UTSA going down to score. Not a very good job by New Mexico's defense of trying to stop them. They scored too easily and very quickly.
They went 80 yards in a minute 50.
Yeah, it's too quick.
UTSA now trying to set it up. It will be Daniel Portillo, who was the field goal kicker last year, so he has some control. He's been the main kickoff man all season long. Austin, Texas native out of Connolly High School, redshirt junior. Hands team is out there for New Mexico. Gibson, one of the running backs, is out there.
Coaches are saying, come on, ball. Come on, ball.
Both
coaches. Coach Davis saying, just grab it. Just grab it.
Dual kickers on the play. A flag is thrown. It may have been offsides. It doesn't matter. New Mexico is able to haul it in, and that will do it. Chris Davis Jr., part of the hands team, corrals it. And Bob Davies, the team was sneaking up on him for the Gatorade shower.
And he won't even care.
Offside. On the kicking team, number 83, the penalties decline. First down.
Big hug for one of his great players in Dakota Cox. And on a cold day in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
They missed.
Come on.
Then the strength coach says, back off, guys.
None of that.
Now they get him. And I think he's probably going to have to dance, too.
I don't even think
Correction.
They got him flush.
The 5-yard offside penalty will be tacked on to the dead ball spot. First down.
There it is. Okay, they got him pretty flush.
And people think coaches are stupid. Why do you let them do that? You have no thought process about, you're so happy you've won the game, you forget about the Gatorade bath. And nobody cares. If you get it, you want it.
First and foremost, and obviously 2 timeouts left with the Raycon Media Camellia Bowl coming up. Let's give credit to UTSA. Outstanding year. This is what you start. When this program was approved in December of 08, started in 2011, eligible for bowls in 14.
Timeout.
They wanted to get here.
UTSA.
And sure enough,
That's
they finally got here. Frank Wilson, after Larry Coker, did
timeout.
A great job of building this program. Frank Wilson did an outstanding job this year getting this team to a bowl game. They had to go on a run after a slow start this year. And Bob Davies, this is a reclamation project. It was when he took the job at New Mexico. The program was 3-33 under Mike Loxley before Davies got here. They had 3 years of probation, losing 5 scholarships from the Rocky Long regime. The program was a bit of an all-time low, really. And Bob Davies built this thing into what is now a back-to-back bowl berth program and its 2nd bowl win in the last 54 years. It's 1st in 9 years.
Yeah, you look at UTSA, they've done a tremendous job. Larry Coker, 8 wins, 7 wins. Now Frank Wilson's come in, and he's won six
time
games, taking them
UTSA
to the first bowl game.
Sir,
and the message he's sending right now, the game's
final
over.
Final timeout.
But the message he's sending right now, while New Mexico fans are booing, let's don't quit till this thing is
sure.
over. Let's give it every
Please
chance.
Please reset the game clock to 21 seconds. 21 seconds.
Who knows if something weird happens in a snap, perhaps? Sure.
We've all seen it, so I don't blame Frank at all. And it's about the message more than it is something else that might happen. But UTSA is in good shape moving forward. 85 kids on this team from the state of Texas. So when UTSA started football, it helped a lot of kids stay at home and get their scholarships paid for.
Lamar Jordan, 81 yards on the ground today, takes the final knee. I saw Richard McCorley, our player of the game, take quite the backflip in the air. And for New Mexico, their second bowl win since the early 60s. And Bob Davey thrown up on the shoulders of the Lobos after a 23-20 win for New Mexico. Impressive stuff from Rock out there. Outstanding job from both Frank Wilson and Bob Davey.